Hi guys, be blessed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We talk about a near-death experience when a person dies temporarily, when his heart stops beating and then comes back to life. People then report that they have left their own body and were able to see their body from the outside. Also, they report on various events that can roughly be divided into two categories. One group sees a bright light, and some also see a tunnel with a light at the end. Some also walk through the tunnel and see deceased relatives at the other end, sometimes even dead friends or angelic beings telling them that they have to go back to Earth again, as it is not their time to die. The other group sees no light, but darkness and sometimes fire. Some feel enormous heat. The experiences of the first category are related to well-being, feelings of love and peace. The second category, with the exact opposite, such as feelings of fear, loneliness and agony. If we now deal statistically with the phenomenon of near-death experience, we can see that the vast majority of people has made experiences with light, tunnel and deceased relatives, just belonging to the first group of those with positive experiences, while a smaller part shares the experiences of the second group, in which darkness, fire and sometimes terrible creatures dominate. According to a study by Oses and Haraldson, 78% of near-death experiences include deceased relatives or friends. A number of other studies have shown that a bright light is perceived by 58-69% and sometimes even up to 77% of people with an NDE. And further studies have shown that the sensation of peace and joy play a role in almost all cases of near-death experiences, namely up to 93%. So the overwhelming majority of people with a near-death experience had a positive experience, so they belong to the first group. The question then is, can these numbers be a measure of what experiences people make after the final death? If we assume that the Bible is true and there is heaven and hell, and people each have seen one of the two places in their near-death experiences, and as Christians we know that these places in fact exist, then we may conclude that most people will obviously go to heaven after they die, based on the frequency of positive near-death experiences. However, we have to be careful with this conclusion, since the persons who have a near-death experience don't die ultimately. Instead, they got only a brief insight, so to speak, which, however, has nothing to do with where they will be after the final death. Here in this last figure, we find evidence to assume that the near-death experience is not a blueprint for subsequent whereabouts after the final death. The study by Kuretsa and Schifano from 2010 included only persons who had a problem with drug abuse, that is, who were addicted to drugs. And as we can see from the diagram, not 93, but still 76% of these people, as shown by the blue bars, have had a positive near-death experience with sensations of peace, joy, harmony and security. And that's amazing, since the Bible teaches us that the price of sin is death. Therefore, the drug addicts were not supposed to have any positive death experience. If the Bible is correct, and as Christians we know that it is because it is the pure and unbiased word of God, then we can conclude that near-death experiences cannot be considered a reflection of the events after the final death. On the contrary, the two events, that is the near-death experience on the one hand and the experiences after the final death on the other, are totally independent of each other. That is, they do not condition. Therefore, we cannot deduce from the nature of the near-death experience on the possible later experience after the final death. So the near-death experience is only a glimpse into the spiritual world, while the decision about the final whereabouts is made by God only subsequent to the final death. For the spiritual world knows that these persons are sent back into their physical bodies and have not died ultimately. Therefore, many people report that they are told by deceased relatives that it is not yet their time and they have to go back. It's quite possible and even very likely that the experiences people make after their final demise differ from the near-death experience. In particular, as the Bible says, that judgment comes only after death, that is, after the final death. And then God decides where the eternal abode of the soul will be. And we know that staying in heaven is not possible without Jesus Christ and without repentance and reversal of lifestyle. This is what Jesus told us in many passages in the scriptures, for example in Luke 13:5. Except you repent, you will all likewise perish. Therefore, we need to assume that the distribution of near-death experiences, as we see it in the statistics, namely in favor of the positive experiences, does not reflect the experiences after the final death, but that the relationship may even be inverted drastically. One may ask then why people are given such a positive experience when they won't have it later. We know that we are all guilty before God, for all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And we also know that only a few will be chosen. When we talk to people in the streets, we know that only a few have a true faith and have given their life to Jesus Christ, our only Redeemer. So we can be very confident that not these 93 and even not 76% of people are qualified for heaven, but that they are probably much less, which I deeply regret, and I wish much more could be saved if they would only realize that they are in this great danger as long as they have not turned to Jesus and repented from their sins. We simply have to recognize that a positive near-death experience with sensations of peace and joy is a gift from God who allows people to take a short look into the spiritual realm. And then, as believers, we must also wonder, how can a person who has had such a near-death experience, even if he was an unbeliever previously, how can he continue to disbelieve after he has had this supernatural experience and this tremendous grace of God to experience the gift of a second chance? How can a man that has experienced this miracle be so ignorant not to fall on his knees in gratitude to his Creator? This is inconceivable to us. To whom it is not clear then that the spiritual realm and the afterlife exist, that the spirit that lives on forever could not have come about by chance and not by evolution, but could only have been created by God, who then simply continues to reject God and his will, there is really no help for such a person. So we don't have to ask here whether it's terrible to show someone heaven in a near-death experience, but not to let him go there later. Rather, it's the other way around, namely, how a person that has been given the tremendous grace of experiencing the spiritual realm can be so ignorant to reject this grace and not to submit to God. This is incomprehensible to a person with a sound mind, for a sound mind tells us beyond any doubt that the spiritual world must exist, because otherwise these experiences cannot happen. And this is also not an automatic program of a dying brain, not mere biochemistry as claimed by some unteachable atheists. Because unfortunately, they deliberately overlook the fact that many people were dead far beyond the point at which the brain could have any life impulse. And unfortunately, they also overlooked that no biochemistry in the world can produce individual near-death experiences in which people talk to deceased relatives, or in which they have experiences of love and security on the one hand, or fear and torture on the other. This is impossible. People see themselves going out of the body. They can later describe exactly what they have seen. And even people who were blind from birth can see anything in their near-death experiences, as evidenced in studies like this one by Ring and Cooper. There are many examples, many known cases describing how people have come back long after final brain death, such as the case of the Japanese Tsuruiku Kiyoshi, who woke up 30 minutes after the final brain death was diagnosed, and he reported a vivid near-death experience. Or the case of Jim Woodford, who returned to his body 11 hours after diagnosis of death, and he lived on. People have near-death experiences, while the brain is dead for a long time. There is massive scientific evidence for this phenomenon, as we can find here in the study by Seven and Spetzler. No, no, people, don't lead us down the garden path. This cannot be caused by biochemistry or a dying brain, but only and exclusively by the spirit. It is self-evident that the spirit continues to live after the death of the body, of a body which is just a vessel for the spirit, a kind of bodysuit. That's the truth that everyone should be aware of. Having said this, we need to be aware of the great danger of misinterpreting positive near-death experiences, since many think that there is no judgment after death, but only peace, joy and harmony. But that's a deception. Some people who had a positive NDE think that they will experience the same peace and joy after their final death, and they even proclaim that nobody needs to be in fear of death. There are many testimonies out there of people with an NDE mentioning exactly this. They even say that they are now free of the fear of death after their NDE, and that the fear of death prevents people from living peacefully and freely as they want. Look at this.
How has your outlook on death and life changed as a result of this experience?
I am definitely no longer afraid of death. And that was something that I had feared my entire life.
Yeah.
And what I learned is that fear of death really prevents you from truly living.
To make it very clear, these people are deceived. Most of them even don't know the Bible. As we know, the NDE is not a copy of the experience after the final death. After death comes the judgment that most of the NDE people didn't see, and so they think there will be none. Some other people are also heavily deceived by regarding the NDE as a confirmation of their esoteric or religious views, and many even fall into the satanic traps of New Age and esoteric after their NDE. How far the deception goes can be seen, for example, here in this video on DMT and out-of-body experiences, which is another term for near-death experience. DMT means dimethyltryptamine, which is the active psychedelic substance in some plants, a psychedelic drug similar to LSD. This channel is reporting of a drug trip a person got after taking this heavy psychedelic drug. It is reported about a positive NDE, and it also proclaims that nobody should be in fear of death. Look at this.
Look, death is going to happen. It's going to happen again. It's going to keep happening numerous times. It's part of the process. Get used to it and get over it. It's not the point. And I find that especially cool because that wasn't what he was going into it about. You know, he usually with a lot of psychedelics, if you've been depressed leading up to it, you're going to have a bad trip. DMT, I feel, from just my experience and what I've seen other people experience, it doesn't care about your feelings.
This shows how heavily people are led astray. And it is completing the full circle we started earlier, where we could see in the scientific study by Kuretsa and Schifano that drug abusers indeed have positive near-death experiences despite their iniquity against God by misusing drugs, which proves beyond doubt that the NDE is not an indication of the later experience after the final death. Here another heavily deceived woman with an NDE claiming that one can even end his life, so doing suicide, and doesn't need to fear death because it's all joy, peace and harmony, and nobody judges you. It's such a pity because these people don't know what they are doing and what disservice they do to others by proclaiming and distributing this lie from the pits of hell. All this misinterpretation and misrepresentation of NDEs is very dangerous as it distracts people from finding God and getting saved by accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Therefore, we urgently need to warn of such misinterpretations. Don't believe that there is no judgment after death. There is judgment, and all people are judged by God's justice. To make it very clear, when you face God at judgment day and haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you will go lost and awake in hell, and there will be no peace and joy anymore. So, unfortunately, I have digressed a bit. I just want to show you what people actually experience when they go through such a negative near-death experience. And then you can decide for yourself whether this is an automatic program of the brain, so to say, mere neurobiochemistry, or real experience. So let's come then to Matthew Botsford's testimony and what he experienced during his death. Matthew is in the second group of those who have had a negative near-death experience because he saw darkness and he saw fire and experienced agony. What he saw during death is what he describes as hell, and what he experienced was unimaginable horror. This is a summary of his testimony as given in various interviews. In this picture here, this is Matthew and his wife. He also wrote a book about his near-death experience. It is entitled A Day in Hell. Before his near-death experience, Matthew was a kind of atheist, as many are today. He had a nebulous notion of God, a higher power, so to speak, no real faith, and he didn't care about what God may expect of him. Rather, he was solely concerned with his own things, things that he enjoyed. But then it happened. In 1992, Matt died as a result of a gunshot wound in the head, and he was reanimated again later. The bullet struck him as he and his two friends left a restaurant, just as some people fired weapons at the restaurant's entrance. The attackers had recently been expelled from the restaurant and didn't want to stand for it. So they went to their car, got some weapons and opened the fire on the restaurant a short time later. Matthew died on the spot. After being dead for several minutes, paramedics could revive him. Matthew has almost no memory of the crime, but he remembers all the more exactly the events that he experienced while he was dead. Matthew described these experiences later in interviews after a long time of recovery. He said, "I felt a strong heat in my head and then everything went black. The next thing I saw was that I was crucified, hanging over a deep abyss. I could not free myself. The crucifixion was a direct mocking of what Jesus did for us. I saw smoke rising up from the abyss above which I was hanging, and I heard all these terrible screams. I want to tell everybody that hell is real. What I experienced was absolutely real. I knew I was completely alone and isolated. There is nothing comparable to what I experienced there. One is completely powerless, and it is a state of utter hopelessness. I was surrounded by the pure evil. It was like getting into a liquid bath of pure evil. Evil surrounds you completely, and there is no way out. As I looked down into the abyss, I saw the magma boiling beneath my feet, and the smoke rising up to me. And I saw four-legged creatures running around. It was extremely hot, and there were demonic creatures all around me. They looked terrible. It was very dark, pitch black. Only by the glow of the magma could I see something. I was completely naked. The lava flowed together under me until my feet got covered by it. I saw my feet burn in the lava, and I could smell the scorched smell. The agony was unbearable. But after my feet were burned and gone, they were restored suddenly, and the torment started over again. It's a never-ending cycle of torture and torment. I didn't know the name of Jesus and never prayed. Therefore, I didn't call the name of the Lord. Suddenly, I saw a group of these terrible creatures approaching me. At first, I only saw eyes, and I heard them mocking me. They knew things of mine that I had done, such as watch unclean videos. Then they began to eat me alive. They had very long claws. They ripped the meat off my bones and ate it. The pain was unbearable, but I did not die. After a short while, the flesh was back on my body, and they started over to eat the flesh from my bones again. It was an unimaginable horror. No, I screamed just like the other people, and I could not stand it. In all this time in hell, which seemed eternal to me, I had neither thoughts about my past nor about the future. The only thing I knew was that I was out of time, and that existence in this horror is forever and ever. I suddenly realized that I was trapped in eternal torment and torture, and I could not escape from it. I was paralyzed with fear. I didn't even wonder why I was there. Then suddenly I saw a hand reaching into the darkness from the outside, as if a hand were reaching through a curtain. The hand was huge and moved in my direction. Something in me told me that this was a good thing. And then I heard a voice. I've never heard such a voice before. It sounded like thunder, lightning, rushing huge water, all in one. I heard that voice speak, "It is not your time." At that moment, I left the awful place and all evil was gone. My sense of being trapped and tortured forever was gone. It was a hand and voice of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, who saved me from this terrible place. I woke up in a hospital room and saw my brother and wife. But what I saw was absolutely real. When we die, there are only two possible places for us to spend eternity, heaven or hell. I have experienced hell, and I want to warn everyone, don't go there. This place is not made for man. Do everything possible to avoid this place. Turn to the Lord Jesus Christ, our only Savior from eternal damnation and hellfire. God bless you.